I find it baffling only because he's well known. He may not be a sort of the biggest star.
People know him now.
But people know him. He was on a show that's fairly popular. A lot of young people know him. When this happened, it did sort of trigger a lot of outpouring of emotional support from a lot of different people, from a lot of different producers and then television people who worked in the sort of entertainment industry. So that's what I find it most disturbing. But I would also say that if this is true, right, as Joey rightfully pointed out, he is innocent until proven guilty. Right. I think the saddest part about this is that he has chosen, if true, to scapegoat Black queer folk who often are in the crosshairs of violence. In the last 5 years, about 128 transgendered people have been killed. The vast majority of them have been Black women. You have higher incidence of suicide from LGBTQ teens, from young people. Just in the past year, we've had two Black gay men die in the home of Ed Buck, who is a Democratic donor. And as far as we know, there's been no investigation. So those things, those crimes are not hoaxes. So it's my hope that this is not used as an excuse to sort of forget about the true violence that's happening in this
community. Let's just be real here. Among the most skeptical people, the early skeptics, were Black queer folk saying, this just doesn't seem to add up. I hope it's, you know, he's not lying.
Right.
But this just doesn't add up.
Right.
Because why? Why do you think they were so skeptical of it?
Well, common sense often always kicks in. I think the way he had outlined or sort of the way the facts were put out, it was a little too perfect. And the idea that at least there were allegations that he kept the rope around his leg for a long time. Did he go to the hospital right away? There didn't seem to be a press conference right after it happened, you know, from his attorneys to sort of outline exactly what happened. Well, what was the extent of his injuries? He said that he, you know, a liquid was poured on him. What was that? There just didn't seem to be enough outrage from him right after it happened in terms of letting us know what the facts are.
I see it this way. Look, the bottom line is when things happen, number one, we live in a very visual society,
exactly.
Right? And generally, when we're having a conversation, Don Midwin, there's a videotape, we're analyzing it, we're dissecting it. That was not the case here. There's a cell phone, there's some surveillance, it was absent. So then you go to the facts and you say, could it have happened? And then you get to the fact it's 2 a.m. And then you get to the fact it's 20 degrees below zero. And then you get to the fact that it's 40 minutes after the fact that you reported. And then you get to the fact that you still have the noose around your neck. And then you get to the fact that you still have your Subway sandwich. And then you get to the fact that you had cell phone records and you were supposed to turn them over, but you redacted them beforehand. And then you get to the fact that I happened to be on the phone with my manager at the time. And so, therefore, people were skeptical as to the story. Now, going back real quick, Don, to what you're talking about why. No one knows why. And the point is, from a prosecutor's perspective, it's not going to even matter because you don't have to establish motive when you're talking about someone filing a false report. You just will have to establish that you did it. And it's troubling. And the other issue is it demeans and undervalues people who are true victims of crime,
right,
who really are out crying for investigations. And not only that, but you're talking about the diversion of resources. Let's keep it real. You want to keep it real? We're talking about Chicago. There's plenty of places that 12 detectives could have been investigating as opposed to executing search warrants. And then factually, they even the police now have the receipt for the noose that's around his neck. I think it's a problematic case.
Well, according to the reports that are out there, and it's even part of the police department, he says that he didn't want to report it, that his friend made him report it, and that's what took so long. Some of those questions has been answered. That
no.
And that he...
Some of the questions he's answered as to whether those answers carry merit or are sufficient, that's another issue. When we're prepping clients, I mean, there are answers to everything.
Yeah.
But the issue is, does it make sense? Mm-hmm. Does it resonate? And when you keep having to explain, why didn't you turn over the full phone
record? And is it credible?
Right.
Does it make sense given the circumstances? Is it reasonable?
Does it?
What? No. Is it reasonable? Would a victim of crime do and say the things that he did? No. You know, I watched his interview on Good Morning America.
Why did he do that interview?
I came away with watching him thinking, I hope he's telling the truth because I'm not convinced.
Okay. So let me say something about this. Someone who sits here every single night and tries to get interviews with people who are involved in the news. oftentimes when people go, they go into crisis PR management. They call a crisis PR person. Yeah. That crisis PR person will tell them, do a morning show. Right. They've got a lot of viewers. Never throw yourself on the mercy of the court. This is not 1997. It's not even 2006. It's not even 20. That exactly. no longer works. This is, and in this particular case, this is not an entertainment story. This has become a political story because of the whole MAGA part. And you know where that is played out and lived daily? In cable news and on social media. Mm-hmm. So if you're going to take your fight, you need to take it to the pit, to where it's happening. It's not happening on morning shows.
That's right.
They talk about the news for a few minutes. Nothing against morning shows. I love all my colleagues there. I think they do a great job. But that's not where it is now, especially when it comes
to
this.
But
I'm saying is that doesn't work. Come on a show like this, or any of my other colleagues, and sit down with us live for an hour or however long it takes, answer the questions that need to be answered from real journalists. I shouldn't say that. From journalists who don't have to worry about the entertainment arm of their particular company.
The real person he needs to answer questions from is the police.
Well,
and one of the, I think, odd aspects of this from the very beginning is this inability to turn over the cell phone.
You may be right about that, but let me tell you this, and Joey, I know this. You can, a good lawyer can get you out just about anything, right? Or reduce whatever it is that you're going to suffer. In the court of public opinion, Jussie has lost. He's right. lost the fight in the court of yeah. public opinion.
Yeah.
And that's where his battle is. Whether legally, if he has to go, whatever he has to serve, if it's jail time, if he has to do probation, if he has to pay, whatever. But in the court of public opinion,
it matters.
It matters. And he lost yeah. that because of how, and not his fault, maybe people were. I don't know what they were saying to him, how maybe because of his representatives. Who knows?
I don't know.
But
if
it was
it's
handled poorly.
Fault. I don't know if it's not his fault, Don. The
you
fact
think
is,
it's his fault? You think he was
is,
doing what he wanted?
Well, he went out and he gave the interview. So understand this. Let's talk from a defense perspective. There's two things to think about. Number one is yeah. the law and whether it makes sense legally to be out there speaking and everything else. From that perspective, it's damning. All those things yeah. you heard him say on TV mm-hmm. are going to be played in a courtroom
That's
in the
right.
event this goes to trial yeah. and it's going to crush him. Now,
yeah.
from a public relations imperative, your people say, oh, get in front of the cameras, express what happened, show some real anger and show some this, that, the other. The fact is that
it's
works from a public
polished.
Relations perspective,
yeah. exactly.
but it doesn't work in this perspective.
It doesn't work. And listen, yeah. again, I want you to say, I have nothing but the utmost respect for my friends at ABC and other things.
Right.
They and Robin did a terrific job on that interview. I'm just talking about how you respond to this sort of crisis. That doesn't really work anymore, and I think that is old school. This is playing out every single moment
yeah.
in cable news. Sean Hannity's going to eat Jussie Smollett's lunch every single second. Tucker Carlson is going to eat Jussie Smollett's lunch every single second.
The president of the United States
is right. going to eat his lunch. And who does the president of the United States watch every night?
You.
Cable news. Yeah, well, cable news. And so
right.
that's all I'm saying. That's all I'm saying.
Well, the pushback on this needs to be that the framing cannot be that simply because of this one case that all the other victims that come forward are somehow
so
no
true,
longer
Midwin,
believed.
But you know that's
really
what
important.
The narrative's going to be.
I know,
though,
but
right?
I know, but it's time yeah. that you know, it's time that we stop being led by other people's
let's
narratives.
Let's talk about the Chicago police too, mm-hmm. because a lot of people don't trust the police, and I know the police are. They are upset in Chicago that they're being portrayed or have been portrayed unfairly in the media. A story that is this high profile, this many ramifications, I'm not sure that the Chicago police would put themselves on the line for something like this when they feel that they don't have something really credible should
well,
make their case. Am I wrong
things.
With that or
no.
prosecutor?
And then you go, then I go.
Two things. Number one, I could talk all night, I'm sure we all can, about the Chicago police and about some of the things that exist as it relates to that police department, as it relates to the Department of Justice, as it relates to their transgressions, particularly as it relates to people of color.
Mm-hmm.
In this case, I don't have things that are bad to say about them. Let me tell you why. They investigated the case. They investigated it thoroughly. When people started speaking about an issue of it could be a hoax and oh my goodness, goodness, they said, we don't have information that would support that at all. And I think they dotted their I's, they crossed their T's, and they were very sensitive with regard to the investigation.
I
so
disagree.
If you want to speak about the police department and their troubles, we can have a conversation about that.
But
a lot of people were wondering where all so much information,
there were leaks coming out almost
every single day. But do we know that the leaks were coming from the police department or just from sources?
They were unnamed sources within the police department. And if you are on top of what it is that you're trying to do and you're trying to sort of project an image of being professional from a police department standpoint, put a cap on that. There was no reason for these sort of leaks to be coming out every other day. It almost made it, it almost kind of gave this image or this impression as though they had this sort of vested interest in making sure that that proving that Jussie was wrong.
Okay,
you understand what I'm saying?
Let me tell you
it's almost
something.
As though they had a vested interest in